in case I haven't made my point abundantly clear by now, Final Fantasy X is one of the worst, most annoying goddamn games I ever played in my life. The story is fucking wretched. The characters are vapid, irritating dill holes. The art and costume design are ridiculous to the point of weeping hilarity. And the plot's got holes in it you could drive a shoe puff through. And it also won a shit ton of awards from virtually every gaming website and magazine on the planet, and is one of the best-selling, most highly reviewed RPGs of all time. So of course, because I live on a planet full of mouth-breathing butt-whistlers who wouldn't know a good plot to an RPG if it dick-whipped them in the goddamn eye, Square Enix granted your wish and made a sequel. Final Fantasy X-2. You could kiss my ass for starters. How about going to hell and taking this fucking game with you? Ain't nobody sticking up for this piece of shit, is there? Even fans of 10 didn't know what to make of this. I mean, what the fuck is going on here? It's just, I don't even know what I'm looking at here. There's singing and... Was anybody really expecting this after Final Fantasy X? What is with this awful, poorly translated, meaningless J-pop, and why is Yuna dancing all of a sudden, and why is Riku a main character now, and I don't even know who the hell that's supposed to be. You spend most of the game looking for new clothes to wear. I'm not even kidding. A major focus of this game is running around and finding lots of sexy outfits. It's all just really goofy, like silly kid shit with a bunch of wacky posing for no reason. And then there's this guy.
Let's go! Party! Party!
But you know what? I get it. No, really. I get what they were trying to do. Hell, I kind of admire this game in a weird way. They were trying to do something new, fresh, and unique. They were trying to inject just a little bit of fun and spirit into what had become a relatively dull, grim, formulaic, and predictable series. Up to this point, the series featured a lot of brooding, whiny, socially awkward assholes full of self-doubt, and lots of very linear storytelling, and believe me, it doesn't get much more linear than Final Fantasy X. X-2, on the other hand, is a very lighthearted adventure with proactive, enthusiastic characters, relatively strong and confident female protagonists, lots of new and upbeat music, and a big emphasis on side questing and exploration. This is basically a sandbox Final Fantasy game with days of playing time worth of side content to discover. Although the act of exploration might have been just a little bit more exciting if you, you know, actually flew the airship around Spirit to see it for yourself instead of just selecting your destination off a list. But I applaud that kind of innovation. I mean, how weird is that, right? I'm the one guy actually offering a defense for this game. In fact, if I'm being embarrassingly honest, I kinda like it. I like it better than fucking 10. At least this game had an identity. You must admit, it did put a new spin on a relatively dull, very tired, very predictable series. Granted, it didn't work here, like, at all, to the point that even hardcore fans have completely rejected this game. But I think I know why. No, well, yes, kind of. This is really the scene that caused almost everyone to turn their consoles off in disgust immediately. It's the first thing we see in this game, and it's all just... Oh god, this is stupid. I mean, what the fuck is that thing? Why is the stage some kind of techno force field head grinning, drumming, Buddha-looking thing? And the song is annoying, the lyrics don't make any sense, and it's that kind of horrible song that gets stuck in your head for weeks? And are we playing a ditzy pop music singer in this game? Because that doesn't really sound like Final Fantasy. It sounds like bullshit. It sounds like Britney's dance beat. And fuck that. But more than that, the game's just all way too girly and Charlie's Angels, and there's dress spheres, and I don't even know what the fuck Hypellos are, and there's a ton of side quests, and there's pop music, and Yuna runs like a girl, and you have to dress like a Moogle, and there's a shitload of fan service. If you look at it from a fan standpoint, this just isn't a Final Fantasy game because they change too much. Again, I like change. I like innovation, but when you change too much, it becomes unrecognizable as a game in the series, and people get mad. When you go overboard trying to reinvent Final Fantasy, it stops being innovation and becomes... well,
Betrayal!
What?
Betrayal!
Uh-huh. You see, are we starting to understand each other just a little bit by now? Now, before you start thinking I'm going soft on this game, oh, it sucks. Believe me, it sucks the shit ring off my toilet, but despite what I said, it's not really about playing dress-up. It's really about finding— No! No! Not him! Damn it, not fucking Titus! Fuck that shit pistol! I hate Titus! Anyone with a working gag reflex hated that whiny fudge plumber, and now the whole game is spent trying to get him back? No! What kind of fucking incentive is that, bringing back Titus? That's like entering a costume contest where the winner gets a fucking tetanus shot. I am not very fucking motivated here, people. So, you know what they added in a desperate attempt to hold your interest? Fan service. Lots of fucking fan service.
And what, you may ask, is fan service?
Oh, yeah, that's the spot. Oh, right there. Yes, don't stop.
For now, let's just say a major part of this game is putting the girls in sexy, revealing outfits. Yuna goes from wearing very conservative clothes in the last game to a short skirt dress when she's singing, and her default costume includes boy shorts. But even that seems mild and modest compared to Riku, who's barely wearing anything at all except for a bikini top and a micro miniskirt with visible thong. But at least for modesty's sake, she's wearing a scarf? I call slut, but at least this fan service is really covering all the bases. I mean, there's variety, if nothing else. We've got the slutty Lolita jailbait, the demure but bi-curious sheltered girl. But you know, I really like the dark, brooding goth chicks. Girls who wear all leather, have a lot of self-doubt, don't say much and mope all the time. If only there was a female version of Squall from Final Fantasy VIII, but with big titties so I could harbor secret fuck fantasies about him, but without it being gay.
It's a little late to be bringing that up.
Viva Rule 63! She's even got a pretentious emo name, Pain. I can almost hear the Evanescence playing whenever she's on camera. Okay, so the game starts off with Yuna giving a pop concert. Riku and Pain immediately jump the stage with swords and attempt to kill everybody, and at least this I can get behind because this music is a diabolical atrocity that must be stopped at once by any means necessary.
Want in on this number? Then show me your moves!
I love how Yuna just completely disregards the two Amazons gruesomely slaughtering her backup dancers with medieval weaponry. She just turns her back on them and shakes her ass. I mean, okay, I know it's not really Yuna, but Jesus, people are getting cut in half up here. Not even Gwar goes as far as outright murder. Usually. Once you've murdered her backup dancers, fake Yuna runs outside while her stereotyped goons run interference, and finally we meet the real Yuna, who's ditched her summoner staff for a pair of handguns, making her the first sensible protagonist in the history of this frigging series since Laguna carried a rifle. It's worth noting, though, that she hits absolutely nothing with this little stunt before they all strike a triumphant Power Rangers pose. Oh my god, this is so cheesy. Quite a long way from the traditional kimono she wore before, and her previous characterization as a kind, demure, religious caregiver with a tragic fate. But is this huge change in outfit and characterization because of the radical cultural shift in Spira because of the exposure of Yevon as a maniacal, genocidal cult run by the undead bent on world domination? Or just because Japanese perverts wanted to see some cleavage and her cute ass in boy shorts? Good question. The answer is yes. Speaking of cleavage, check this shit out. The fake Yuna is revealed to be someone named LeBlanc in some kind of holographic disguise.
You give us back Yuna's garment grid right now!
Very well, it's yours.
Her true form is that of... You know, I don't even know how to describe it. An exotic fan dancer with a plunging neckline that plunges so far, you can see her thong. A lot of double-sided tape went into this outfit. So here's what drives the story and the combat in Final Fantasy X-2, the dress spheres. It's some kind of ancient holographic technology that allows the girls to change clothes in a very elaborate flowery transformation sequence. Each outfit you get grants a different set of powers which work like jobs from earlier Final Fantasy games. Yuna now has the Songstress dress sphere, which lets you do exotic dances that cause status effects on monsters like blindness.
This is a little embarrassing.
Yes. She dances so poorly it causes people to go blind. Who could possibly do a dance so horrifying it blinds people? Oh god, no! Why do I ask these questions? Why, French Conan? Keep your thong on my eyes! God! Oh, back to the game. Man, this dress fear thing, I just don't get any of this. It doesn't make any sense. And why is this even a fight? LeBlanc's fighting 1-on-3 against people armed with swords and firearms. And a microphone. I don't know. She's wielding a fucking fan! And why did she give the garment grid back to Yuna if she was just planning on killing her anyway? And why did LeBlanc steal the garment grid in the first place? To do a concert? To look like Yuna? Why does the garment grid change LeBlanc's physical appearance to look exactly like Yuna? And how did LeBlanc know it does that when every other time it's used for anyone else, it just changes your clothes? And it somehow creates firearms, robot suits, and 40-pound buster swords out of thin air. I mean, it can do that? How? This garment grid thing bugs the shit out of me, because it's one of those things I'm just supposed to accept blindly without any explanation, and I need one! What are the garment grids, like a science or magic or what? Why does changing clothes grant me completely different skill sets and or magic powers? Why do I forget how to use a sword or forget how to use black magic just because I happen to have changed clothes? What, does the dress sphere completely rewrite your brain chemistry like in The Matrix? Well, it certainly seems to when Yuna starts dancing uncontrollably. Wouldn't that scare the shit out of you?
That can happen when you use the garment grid. The emotions of the person recorded in the sphere pass to the user.
Isn't that dangerous?
I can't really say.
But it's your invention.
Alright, wait, I don't get this. So the kid invented the garment grid and spheres contain emotions? Okay, how? Why? What are spheres anyway? I mean, what's their function? What are they made of? And how were they recorded? And with what? And how do they contain emotions? How is that even possible? And the kid's name is Shinra? As in Shinra from Final Fantasy VII? But that's impossible. I mean, aren't they completely different stories? Right? Okay, but if they are in the same continuity, does that make Final Fantasy X-2 a prequel to 7? Why? And what does that accomplish? And what? Okay, if Shinra invented the garment grid, how come I find other garment grids in treasure chests hidden in ancient temples built long before Shinra was born? Oh god, somebody help me. I don't know what's going on, and my brain is melting, and I haven't been even playing for an hour yet. Oh, for fuck's sake, the Albed language shit again? They expect you to go tracking down the translation markers again?
Go digging in the Beacon-El Desert. Expose yourself to the language as much as possible.
Expose yourself to my cock. I already did this shit the last fucking game, and I didn't care that time either. Hell, Riku's one of the core characters. She's an Albed. She knows the fucking language. She grew up speaking the fucking language.
Go digging in the Beacon-El Desert.
Go digging in my shit for corn. Why can't I just ask Riku to teach me the fucking language? It's her native fucking language. And besides, do you really think this guy is spilling some mind-blowing secrets to fucking enlightenment in this scene to warrant a second fucking playthrough? Fuck you! Fuck your busy work!
Miss Yuna, what can I do for you?
Oh, Jesus, I forgot about the blue Jar Jar fuckers. Fuck these guys, too!
Our barkeep's a high color. No one knows his real name, so everyone just calls him Barkeep.
That is a problem. Let me see if I can solve that one. Ask him his fucking name! God damn it! So, the premise is that Yuna and the others are sphere hunters. And by sphere hunters, I basically mean thieves in the same way that Indiana Jones is an archaeologist. Only the stuff the Gullwings are after is, by and large, valueless crap.
Treasure sphere waves, they're coming from those ruins they found at Gagazet.
Okay, so spheres emit waves of what?
Hey, the rocks are floating! Don't tell me we gotta climb up that thing!
No worries. I'll take you to the top.
Okay, so by take you to the top, he means push you out of the fucking airship to fall 60 feet onto the narrowest, most dangerous precipice imaginable. It's a miracle they all just didn't die right there. Yuna faints from vertigo immediately, and the girls catch her as she falls.
Disasterific!
Disasterific is not a word.
Okay, no, I'm not counting ass shots anymore. Before, it was just a funny quirk of the game's direction. Here, it's intentional fan service. They pull Yuna back onto the ledge and run into LeBlanc and her cronies again. And get used to me saying that.
LeBlanc, remember that name well, loves.
It turns out the LeBlanc Syndicate's a rival group of Sphere Hunters, but really they just come off as a less threatening version of Team Rocket because all they do is show up every 30 minutes to get their asses kicked.
Prepare for trouble!
Make it double!
Once you beat them down again, they run off, and then it's a race to the top of the mountain to get the Sphere. Wait, hang on. I thought the guy flying the airship promised he was taking us to the top.
No worries. I'll take you to the top.
I mean, that's not something one should easily screw up. The top should be relatively easy to find. It's an unambiguous measure of altitude. Go as high as possible. That's the top. And how did LeBlanc get to the summit of Mount Gagazet at virtually the same time as the Gullwings when she doesn't have an airship? I mean, it's clear on the other side of the continent, and the Gullwings have the only airship in existence. Well, when you get to the top, you find all three of them hanging from a ledge helplessly. How did they get there?
Would you stop staring?
And instead of saving them, you just walk on like you don't see nothing. I mean, wow. You can't even attempt to save them from falling to their deaths if you wanted to. You aren't given an option. Look at this. I'm just gonna loot their fucking treasure chest right in front of them and walk off laughing. Like a boss. That is cold as ice. When you reach the top of the mountain, you find the Sphere, but predictably it's guarded by a boss monster. A giant enemy crab! Sadly, it has no weak point you can attack for massive damage, but it's pretty easy anyway, and you finally get a hold of this wave-radiating sphere and take a look at its contents. Worth the trouble! I am so glad we risked our lives on that fucking mountain tracking that thing down.
It's not very exciting.
Junk.
You scored the Black Mage dress... Wait, Black Mage? Was there a Black Mage in that sphere? Was there a Black Mage recording the sphere? The hell is going on? No sooner do you finish watching that sphere that sensors detect two more of them. I guess they weren't emitting enough sphere waves before, but now they are. Fucking sphere waves.
There's at least one on Besaid Island, and another in the Xanarkand Ruins.
Really? You didn't think to check Xanarkand for spheres about Titus? You know, the guy who comes from Xanarkand? The guy who never shut the fuck up about being from fucking Xanarkand that entire fucking game? And that wasn't the first fucking place you looked? One of the greatest machina-using civilizations in the world's history with millions of fucking people in it, and it just now occurred to you to look in fucking Xanarkand? Fuck, this is stupid! Oh god, I hate this fucking game! Deep Wang! So you go to fucking Besaid Island to get the sphere out of there and check up on Waka and Lulu's new baby because all those treasure sphere waves being emitted from there can't be good for a child. I'm sorry, I can't get over the sphere waves.
Waka, a daddy!
And yeah, store that thought away for a future nightmare. Waka ejaculating and creating a new life form.
I mean, how do I know how a father's supposed to act in front of his kid?
Here's a free one. Stop styling your hair like a quail's head. This scene establishes why Pain is here to replace Lulu, who's now pregnant with Waka's freak seed. Great maternity wear, Lulu. She's still wearing the same ridiculous clothes now. And actually, now that I think about it, since she's pregnant, does that mean her boobs are actually gonna get bigger? Minor tangent, but just looking around, the world is reacting with surprising calm to learning their entire global religion was a genocidal lie for 1,000 years. I'd expect Waka at least to have some major mental problems. That guy was a serious Yevon freak.
Oh god! Yevon lied to me, huh? I believed in you!
I've got this key with the emblem of Besaid on it. How did 900,000 gil eat my tits? This ain't exactly a mint-condition copy of Action Comics #1, you know. The fuck do I care about a key? I'll be back. Heading out to find the sphere, you get to see all the new monsters this game has to offer. Like, no new monsters at all, just the exact same dogs and evil scoops of ice cream we fought the entirety of the last game. You know, I highly doubt they came up with more than 5 or 6 original monsters since the previous game, aside from palette-swapping other monsters. Eventually, you find a bunker locked with a passcode, where I think this game could have perhaps saved itself by crossing over with the Fallout universe. Alas, no. You find the sphere inside, which is naturally guarded by a boss.
Find the sphere and the fiends appear.
Actually, yeah, what is it with these spheres attracting fucking archdemons to protect them? What do monsters care about spheres except for the fact that they're shiny? The way these things attract big badass monsters, you'd think people would want them as far away from themselves as possible, or even destroyed outright. I don't know, well, let's see the sphere, I guess. I mean, the first one was a dud, but they gotta get better from here, right? I'm sorry, how exactly are we making money doing this again? I mean, what the fuck was that? That was 10 seconds of a staticky waterfall. Great job, guys! Let's throw this shit on eBay, our retirement's secure! Oh, but which, what am I thinking? We couldn't possibly sell this. It belongs in a fucking museum.
I know everything.
Okay, smartass. How do we get Titus back?
I'm just a kid.
Kid is seriously starting to piss me off. You go to Xanarkand next, which has become a tourist attraction the 2 years since you've been there. A tourist attraction with deadly ninjas and snakes made of miniguns. And it seems you're not the only group of sphere hunters with designs of plundering the ancient ruins.
We're sphere hunters! The kindergartens!
Oh my god! I could have gone to med school and instead I played this fucking game! I can't... It's so stupid! How does this series even have fans? I can't... You're watching this, right? I implore you! Am I wrong?
The Kindergartens tell you they have part of some password, which is key, and it's not long before you find a ninja on a radio who tells you the other part.
Oh, hey, I wanted to double check that clue. It's Mon, right? Nah, it's just that I heard some kid saying it was key.
It's monkey.
Yeah, I figured it was Mon. Over and out.
Put it together, fuck pump, it's monkey.
The clues are key and Mon?
It's monkey! How do you not get this?
Keymon?
It's monkey! Monkey! You vapid whores!
Monkey!
Ah! Oh my god!
Monkey!
Monkey!
What unholy terror is this? It's like she's possessed by a demon or she's become some kind of wooden puppet. The eyes, they're flat and lifeless like a doll's eyes, and what is with the lip flaps?
Monkey!
It's like the word monkey's got six syllables all of a sudden.
Monkey!
Oh, and speaking of monkeys, we should get something out of the way right now. It has to do with the subquests. This game is full of subquests. In fact, subquests probably compose the majority of the game's content. There's optional dungeons, lots of those, huge ones to unlock limit breaks, additional powers, and really bizarre dress spheres like the Lady Luck, Gun Mage, Trainer, and the Mascot, all of which you'll probably never use. And there's Blitzball. Oh god, is there a fuckload of Blitzball, because I couldn't get enough of that in the first fucking game. There's Sphere Break, which will probably take about 20 hours and cause you to eat your controller in rage. There's monster hunting, there's chasing butterflies, there's puzzles, there's chocobo ranching. And as for monkeys, there's also a subquest where you have to pair up dozens of monkeys in the Xanarkand ruins so they can all have babies. Look, I can put up with an insane amount of bullshit from Square. I played the Bouncer for fuck's sake, but I refuse to put up with a fantasy RPG that seriously expects me to play for a fucking hour running back and forth trying to get monkeys to fuck. So yeah, I don't give a crap about the subquests in this game, and I didn't waste my time doing hardly any of them. It's not like you need them. They're really just there for the most obsessive of completionists and the people who want to attempt to get the special ending you get for 100% completion of the game, which is basically impossible to do even if you know what you're doing, have a strategy guide in your lap as you play it, and even then, it'll still probably take you 2 complete playthroughs to do it. Do you even know how easily you can get fucked over if you're going for 100% completion? If you do every single thing there is to do in this game but miss one piece of dialogue, 99% no special ending. One line of dialogue the game deems important in 50-60 hours of gameplay. And that includes random people in town who just shout stuff you have no reason to talk to. If you miss one, 99%. If you leave the screen before their text bubbles disappear on their own, 99%. You'll never know what you missed either or where. So, 100% completion? I got 3 words for you. YouTube and fuck that. Trust me, it's not worth it. Oh, but I'll show it to you anyway. Stay tuned for part 2. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to use my penis on something. You know, I already feel so much better from last time now that I'm not doing any of the stupid side quests from this game. No Blitzball, no Sphere Break. The best part of this game is the feeling I get whenever I skip those pointless, shitty minigames. In fact, without all that stuff, the game's only about 25 hours long, and most of that is leveling up your dress spheres. And oh man, is that drawing magic all over again. You see, character levels are one thing, dress spheres are another. Dresses level up separately from your character, and you gain points every time you use a job ability so you can get more job abilities. Problem is, you need a lot of points, there are a lot of dress spheres, and getting points takes a lot, repeat a lot of time. You'll spend days just running around in circles around a save point, fighting the same monsters over and over and over again, which I guess is pretty standard if you played old school RPGs, but geez, here it's just tedious and it really breaks up the game's momentum, especially when you find the trick to maxing out your dress spheres with basically no effort. I think everyone figured this out at some point playing the game. All you have to do is find an elemental monster and have your white mage cast Reflect on the party. Since elementals only have one attack, that's casting an element spell, the spell will bounce off your party and hit the monster. So the monster can't touch you, and you can pretty much use any ability you want, as many times as you want, since the monster is healing itself with its own reflected spells. Nobody is hurting anybody, you're getting job points, and you can max out all your dress spheres in one combat given enough time and patience.
Oh great, once again, a game I can play without actually looking at it. You know guys, if I can play the better part of your game while comfortably reading a book, and I did, you have failed as storytellers! And programmers!
Even so, the combat and job system are still easily the best parts of this game, despite my bitching. I'd even go so far as to say that despite it being very easily exploited in many different ways, there's a lot of depth and strategy to be discovered. It's just too bad the diverse job system is buried beneath the flimsy excuse of the dress spheres. It's still better than the fucking sphere grid from 10. Way better.
Oh god, that sucked.
Can you believe I didn't even mention that in my review of 10? That was one of the worst things about it. At least here you can just pick any ability you want to master. It's straightforward, that's all I'm asking for. As with the last game, it's the story that downright insults you with its near-constant facepalm-worthy nonsense and completely unrelatable protagonists. Take this one, in which you play a group of ditzy girls who dress like skanks and fly around the world murdering people for shiny balls that contain recordings with less worthwhile content than a video of Keyboard Cat. I'm not even joking, I mean, I know this is a video game, and I'm supposed to just think of these poor bodyguards I'm gunning down by the hundreds as mere obstacles that turn into coins when they die, but my god, these poor fuckers are dying to protect this? This is not an end that justifies the means! Anyway, back to Xanarkand. You fight a boss there that's recycled shamelessly from the last game, only to find it's guarding a broken piece of a sphere instead of a whole one. So, once again, our diligence is so richly rewarded, I could piss myself.
All that for nothing.
So, back to the ship to go chasing down another sphere! Second verse, same as the first, and the third, and fourth, and fifth.
We're getting reports of an awesome sphere. Looks like it's already drawn quite a crowd.
Oh, are you detecting waves of awesome coming off that sphere too? Set course, warp factor one.
I wonder what this awesome sphere is like. Well, it's definitely awesome. It will be, won't it?
It's just gotta be awesome because the guy looking at the radar told us it was. It sure would have been nice though if his radar had told us not to go after those spheres that were pieces of fucking shit. How do you know it's awesome? And what does that even mean?
We're getting reports of an awesome sphere.
Oh, I see. He's getting reports.
Okay, assholes. I'll play. Reports from who? What are people just getting on their ham radios and calling it in? I mean, why would they do that? Tell a bunch of sphere hunters about it who are just gonna come down and steal it from them. And how do they know it's awesome? If they know it's awesome, logically they must have seen it. And if they've seen it, why don't they just tell you what's on it and save you the trip? Otherwise, they haven't seen it and therefore have no idea whether it's awesome or not!
This whole thing with the sphere waves is such a transparent plot device. This guy might as well just say, I just read ahead in the script, guys. The plot says we should go over to Killika Village for the next thing to happen. This is the first time we get a good look at the cultural impact of Sin's destruction. There's a lot of tension between the two big religious factions new on Spirit to the point that violence has started to break out between them. And honestly, I really don't understand what either side's deal is. The first is the religion of New Yevon, which is just weird. I mean, New Yevon? What do they believe in, that Yevon wasn't such a bad guy? The dude was a genocidal theocrat who killed millions when he used magic to become a flying Godzilla. At the risk of violating Godwin's law, isn't that a lot like being a neo-Nazi? Why would anyone join New Yevon when Yevon was the guy who butt-fucked this very village with a goddamn tsunami? As for the Youth League, I guess their organizing principle is not being old? Wearing ridiculous thongs? I don't know. It's really not much of a theology, even compared to New Yevon. I mean, say what you like about the tenets of National Socialism, dude. At least it's an ethos. I don't know. Maybe the writers are trying to illustrate some kind of generational gap, which might resonate just a little bit better if I ever saw a single character in this game over the age of 30 except Macon, and he's dead. When you get to where the awesome sphere is, the Youth League is besieging the New Yevon Temple and trying to extort the sphere away from them. That's when the New Yevon guys, who I remind you are explicitly against the use of Machina, attack you with a fucking Judge Dredd battle robot.
Nice knowing you!
And does a single member of the Youth League help you out in this fight? Hell no! There is no way this awesome sphere can possibly live up to the hype, you know. Come on, what could be on this sphere that's so awesome? Awesome! No, actually, we see a guy who looks like Titus, but who doesn't dress like nearly as much of an idiot.
You know, you're all I can count on to save land.
I gotta admit, not really feeling the awesome on this one. I guess if we're grading on a curve of all the spheres we've seen so far, maybe.
Well, now this isn't any fun at all.
I really gotta let off some steam.
What do you got in mind?
Why don't we ask Unit to dance?
That's a good idea, weird gas mask wearing perverted freak child. Why are you wearing a gas mask?
Oh? Oh, that's it!
You must dance. Our sanity depends on it.
That sounds like an order, Yuna.
Well, she's strangely into the idea. And here the flimsy plot gets derailed completely so you can prepare for a concert. You pick up some hitchhiking musicians whose costumes are so ridiculous and awkward they can't even walk. Oh, what? You think I'm exaggerating? You think I'm nitpicking? These assholes are literally stuck in the hallway, unable to move, and need to be pushed into the elevator to do the concert. This is a thing that is actually happening. I mean, why? Why do I have to do this? And why are the controls for this so fucking atrocious? All I want to do is push these fuckers in the elevator, but it's a task that's virtually impossible because the controls are so goddamn crippled. I mean, look at... I want to push the guy forward in a straight line in the elevator, but I can't, it's like they move around like on a fucking air hockey table or an ice rink or something, and then... And oh, Jesus, I gotta do this two more times? I can barely get behind these guys, let alone see them. I mean, oh, what the fuck is this? Christ, the fucking camera is horrible. I just want the fat bitch to go in the fucking elevator. I mean, what the fuck? In real life, this wouldn't be a problem. You just get behind the fucker and push, but in no way, with no combination of mind-altering fucking drugs, could anyone think this is a well-designed, interesting, fun part of the game. I mean, look at this! What the fuck am I doing? I am pushing a fat fucker with bongo strapped to his gut into an elevator. If he'd fucking go in, I mean, oh, fuck, what the fuck? He bounced! He bounced out of the elevator, and now he phased through solid matter. I mean, what the fuck are these guys anyway? Of course, they'd have to be furries, even though we never see a single representative of their respective races outside of this fucking concert. You know, I'm hearing a lot of instruments at this concert, like snare drums and an electronic keyboard. But you know what I'm not hearing is a blue fucking lizard slapping gut bongos, a man-sized eagle strumming a fucking harp, and a nightmare cat creature simultaneously playing a didgeridoo, and some kind of two-headed horn I can only assume is attached directly up his ass. Come on, even songs written by the monkeys had more substantive lyrics than this.
Monkey!
No, these monkeys. You're telling me she doesn't know the words to any songs? This is her whole set? This music is almost as bad as that one time I got tricked into going to the Nostalgia Chicks accordion recital.
believe this? They didn't even attempt to make the lip flaps sync up with the singing. This is horrible. Her mouth's just lazily opening and closing like a fish. La 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 la
la la. Intruders. Anything missing? Still investigating.
The broken sphere from the Xanarkin ruins is missing.
Looks like the burglar left us a present.
Oh, I guess the sphere wave detector was broken when she brought that fucking beast on board your own ship! Okay, last time I rag on the sphere waves, I promise, but come on, I'm a little confused here. I thought spheres were some kind of ancient technology made of fireflies or the souls of the dead or some crap, but apparently anyone can make them anytime they want with custom logos.
Who's on top now, Dull Wings? It'll be 1,000 years before you can take on the mighty LeBlanc.
That's right, Dull Wings. Once again, you see the power of the imperious forces of... What the fuck? I can't stop it. I have Parkinson's. Oh my god, seizure!
It'll be 1,000 years before you can take on the mighty LeBlanc.
She got us.
Oh, poop. Yuna, don't talk like that!
Poopy? Oh, such language, Yuna. And from a high summoner, too.
We're gonna take it back. No one messes with us.
I want her dead! I want her family dead! I want her house burned to the ground!
We're forgetting who we are. We're sphere hunters, the Gull Wings.
In retaliation for this theft, the ladies decide to break into Chateau LeBlanc and steal the broken sphere back, but it's too heavily guarded for a direct assault, so instead, they decide to disguise themselves in the uniforms of LeBlanc's female ninjas and sneak in. But this means having to travel the globe trying to find the uniforms first.
Beat them up and steal their uniforms. Three of them.
Damn! If only we had some kind of magic device that would allow us to instantaneously recreate any suit of clothes we wanted at any time. This plan relies rather heavily on the flimsy assumption that when LeBlanc's ninjas show up to work, they don't make them, you know, take their masks off or have some kind of security code or password.
Monkey!
Hey, here's a plan. Fly circles around the building and reduce it to rubble with your airship's tactical missile strike capability. I'd give that bitch about an hour to turn over the sphere and all the other spheres she has, and then I'd pound this entire fucking city into scorched glass with my ballistic nuclear cock! So you go looking for uniforms on the sacred Ronso Mountains, only to approach the top and find the whole place impassable.
This is suicide, turn back!
It's Saruman!
But if you keep exploring a little, you find a hot spring in the mountain where two of LeBlanc's lady ninjas are upping the fan service ratio.
That water felt great. Can you believe there's a hot spring in a place like this? But isn't this supposed to be sacred Ronso ground?
The rock Yuna's standing on falls into the water and scares the ladies off, leaving one of their uniforms behind. And that's when this game stops even pretending it's actually about something.
Well, as long as we're here.
On sacred ground?
No one's looking.
Yeah, Kamari's a good friend, and we are kinda responsible for getting his entire race exterminated. I'm sure he won't mind us rinsing our dirty vaginas off in his sacred pool. After a minute or so, we find the girls are now in bikinis, which I guess we're forced to believe they brought with them on the mountain. What I really love about this scene is that Riku is now wearing a swimsuit that somehow covers more of her body than her normal clothes. Well, I guess now we know why the combat system makes it so easy to play this game with one hand.
What have we here?
What?
Whatever. I know who's got it going on.
I'm sorry. Is that a chick thing? I mean, I wouldn't know, but do women routinely go up to each other in the shower and compare the size of their boobs? Because I gotta tell you, guys don't do that. Guys do not look over at the other guy pissing next to them in the public bathroom and go, nice. I mean, not the places I go to. I mean, Jesus, like, look, even if this does happen somewhere, I certainly hope it doesn't happen when the other person in question is your fucking cousin. Because that's what they are. Yuna and Riku are cousins. I mean, oh, it's just creepy that you're getting any kind of sexual vibe between these two. Blech. You know what's even worse is this fucking guy, who's also Yuna's cousin, and we're reminded constantly of the fact that he's trying desperately to bone her, too.
Leader must be tough.
Sicko!
Dancing, Yuna, I want to see.
It'll cost you.
You got problems, Japan.
You got big problems. A subplot of this game is an incestuous love triangle? I'd expect this kind of depravity from pervy slashfic writers on the internet, but not you.
You should check out Pain.
This review brought to you by Schmitz Gay.
Now I'm a seaside Satan, just a smoking and a drink and a ringside. I'm down of the world. Down of the world.
Do I really come across that way?
After you leave the hot springs, the two female goons from before confront you and you beat them up. So, shouldn't I now have three uniforms already?
No, absolutely not.
No, of course not. You have to complete two other missions to get those. Okay, what the hell are these two wearing? Really, I defy you to explain this to me. Is this a uniform, or what is it? Who gets up in the morning and just decides, you know, I'll go with thigh-high boots with garters attached to my purple corset with shoulder pads, and under that, my green and yellow front zipper turtleneck bikini. No pants, baby! That's how the Youth League rolls. No pants! Pretty much every time you find a uniform, it's around another dress sphere, and you have to fight LeBlanc's two goofy henchmen. Every fucking time.
What? You're not giving it back? The nerve!
What is with the lip flaps?
The nerve! The nerve!
Seriously, Square Enix did not give a shit! After that, you go to another place, fight the two henchmen again, and finally you get all three uniforms and infiltrate LeBlanc's base, where you find the two henchmen again. These guys are everywhere. How are they getting to all these places all over the world? Are they walking?
You, go to the boss's chambre and tend to your duties.
What duties?
You know, use your talents to help her unwind.
Oh no. And here I thought the game couldn't possibly get any more shameless. It's become full-fledged spank material now. Duty calls. Give LeBlanc the massage of a lifetime. Watch her reaction and adjust your technique accordingly for peak pleasure. Objective: satisfy LeBlanc. Okay, well, that's it. It's over. Final Fantasy's dead. This is where it died. I mean, it was bad before, but we've officially reached rock bottom. Seriously, we're playing a minigame where the goal is to give LeBlanc an orgasm. Oh, come on. Close your eyes and tell me that's not what's happening here.
That's nice. Ooh.
Ah, there! Woo! You're good!
And guess what? This scene leads to absolutely nothing. Nothing at all. You learn nothing, you get nothing, and the end result of this exercise is nothing but a sticky controller. After that, you find a secret door in the basement where the girls ditch their costumes, because what are the odds they'll need those disguises down here?
Oh. The gull wings!
Well, gosh, I guess they're fucking idiots then. So you fight the fat guy again. Guy's got balls, I gotta give him that, going 3-on-1. And he's learned some new moves after watching some more Pokemon episodes.
I choose you.
And after you beat him, you find LeBlanc's private chamber where there's another sphere just laying around. You know, I gotta admit, for the first time in this game, I'm actually curious. What could be on this sphere so titillating that LeBlanc feels compelled to hide it in her secret love nest?
Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and...
Oh yeah, it's a cheap shot, but you know, sometimes those are the most satisfying.
3 + 1 makes how many?
And yeah, nothing happens in this one either.
It's a dud.
Oh, well, imagine that. We wasted our time, killed dozens of people, and busted our asses on a cross-country journey, all for a fuzzy sphere in which we learned, jack fucking shit, just like every other goddamn sphere we've run across on this fucking trip. I wonder if anyone's starting to sense a pattern at this point. You know, if I wanted to waste my time watching something short with bad audio that's too dark to see clearly, I'll watch one of the Cinema Snobs early videos. BAM!
Only naughty girls would scrounge through other people's bedrooms.
This is what? The second time I've had to fight these guys in 5 minutes? These guys get beat more than the Pittsburgh Pirates. Say what you want about the LeBlanc Syndicate's dress code, they've got a killer medical plan. I sure hope you're not sick of fighting these guys like I was 3 fights ago. Because once you find the stolen sphere, LeBlanc throws them at you. Fucking again.
Time to clobber the robber.
Oh,
God, I need a break. This game is driving me nuts. Here, why don't you take over, get some footage for part three? I'm gonna go watch a movie. For you. I was worried sick. You can't go running off like that, buddy, okay? Jeez, a lot of carbon scoring here. You been hanging out with Linkara again? Dr. Insano?
Well, you're back now, and that's what's important. And hey, we can finish Final Fantasy X-2 now. So I get the feeling someone from the game's gonna try to kill me again, as usual. You're my secret weapon.
So, well, come on, let's go! Hey, but no more running away, alright? You're my best bud, and the show's not the same without my robot main man. Okay, so after beating LeBlanc and her goons for, what, the 10th time, you finally get both halves of the broken sphere. And for the first time ever, the Gullwings finally discover a sphere that has something mildly informative on it! It's a recording of some giant ancient machine which you discover is called Vegnagun. It's a world-destroying superweapon that somehow everyone in the whole world already knows about, except the Gullwings. Alright, well, I have to nitpick the hell out of this scene because, well, I'm me, and these spear things just bug the shit out of me. Just, example, tell me this. Who took this footage? What did they do, bring in a crane to get these dramatic sweeping shots of Vegnagun? And someone had to edit this. In ancient Spira. What, did they make non-linear sphere editing software? And what was the purpose of this recording? Was it some kind of Vegnagun sales video, but the audio is missing?
It's the new Vegnagun ZX-5000. The exciting new cutting-edge phenomenon in mechanized genocide delivery. Is another sovereign nation accusing you of saber-rattling or questioning the size of your mighty majestic penis? Well, they'll question no more when you deploy your nuclear armament through Vegnagun's intercontinental missile-launching mile-long cock cannon. Vegnagun is equipped with the latest anti-theft artificial intelligence. Vegnagun is quick, nimble, and more responsive than any other walking terror mecha thanks to its new innovative musical keyboard interface. It's the miracle pipe organ technology that makes this super weapon possible. Even if smaller infantry threats manage to breach Vegnagun's outer vaginal defenses, its point defense tusks will ensure that your bridge is, in every way, impregnable.
If anyone uses that thing, Spira is done for.
But it's a machina! All we have to do is shaky-shake our way up to it and take it apart!
Shaky-shake? Anyway, Vegnagun's being held by New Yevon and Bavel, and LeBlanc offers her breasts, I mean, her services to your boobs, I mean, bras, I mean, cause! Offers her services to your cause!
I thought our peaceful days would never end. The eternal calm. I really believed it would last forever.
Oh yeah, yeah, you really ended war and conflict for all time, Yuna, bravo. Hey, I can't remember, how many people did we end up shooting in the face to steal all those worthless spheres again? Just look at all this peace you've brought to the world.
It's obvious we nabbed the head honcho.
Our target is the New Yevon Praetor, Barilai!
A girly man like that doesn't stand a chance without his escort.
Oh, matron, yes.
You go to the Cloister of Trials under Bavel, and of course you find it infested with fiends. And by fiends, I mean the same demonic ice cream scoops you always fight. You know, you'd think after two games and this much time in development, they'd come up with at least, I don't know, a couple new monsters instead of palette-swapping lizards and ice cream scoops and bats. Well, I suppose there are some robots a little later on when you get to the secret Vegnagun hangar, but riddle me this. Why do Pyreflies erupt from destroyed robots? Aren't Pyreflies supposed to be the souls of the dead?
The boss of this fucking place sucks my fudge nut. He spams death like a bitch.
So you beat him, you beat another guy, and then you beat... Wait, is that Bahamut? Yeah, Mega Flare, that is fucking Bahamut. Didn't we kill all the Aeons at the end of Final Fantasy X? The fuck is going on?
Ever heard of asking?
Okay, well, I'll just tell you. It's skipping ahead a little bit, but fuck it. You know the Shuyin guy who looks like Titus? He was a famous blitzball player in Xanarkand during a time when Xanarkand was at war with Bavel.
To save his girlfriend, a singer-slash-summoner named Len, from dying in the war, Shuyin went to Bevel to steal Vegnagun. And why Bevel never just, you know, used Vegnagun to win the war outright is never explained. Shuyin actually gets in and starts to power up the machine, which is inexplicably controlled by some kind of pipe organ keyboard interface. I mean, why? But Len follows him to try and talk him out of it, but this delay allows guards to catch up with them and riddle them all with bullets. So of course Shuyin is killed from all this, but if you've been paying any attention at all, you'd know being dead never stopped anyone in Final Fantasy X. Shit, on Spirit, death is something you just walk off. I don't know, it just seems like being dead makes you stronger and indestructible. Everyone should do it. But here's the thing, Shuyin is so dead, and so pissed off about that and his dead girlfriend, that he somehow has gained the power to resurrect and corrupt all of the old Aeons into serving him. Yeah, because the unsent, they can do things like that. Maybe his emo-ness gives him strength. Now, you might be asking yourself, well, if Shuyin, a loser blitzball player, he can come back from the dead as an unkillable badass, able to possess people and control the wills of men, and resurrect the most powerful guardian spirits in the world and twist them to his dark purposes, why didn't Len come back? I mean, she's a summoner, right? Well, it's very simple. It's because her spirit became a sphere instead.
Yeah, the girl from the Songstress dress sphere.
That's Len?
Sure. She wore that dress 1,000 years ago.
You know, it makes sense. If you don't think about it at all. When you finally get to where Vegnagun is, there's no Vegnagun, just a big hole in the wall.
I must report to Nuji Wuji at once. Boys, record this. Don't miss a single detail.
Wait, stop, hold it. Look at that. What is that? They do have cameras. I thought videos were recorded on spheres in this reality or some shit. Wasn't that the whole fucking point? Isn't this supposed to be like a less technologically sophisticated age than the ones devastated by sin? Where the hell did the camcorders come from? I have so many questions. What did they record on? DV tape? SD card? What the fuck? What's really happening with the Aeons is that monsters are pouring out of all the temples across Spira because the Dark Aeons are infesting them and perverting nature. So you have to go around clearing them out. When you get back to Besaid, you find Waka arguing with a Youth League guy who just wants to burn the temple down and kill the monsters inside without endangering the civilians.
It would be so simple to burn this place down and take the fiends with it.
But poor Waka can't bear to destroy a place that he's lived with, loved, and cherished his whole life.
We can finish off the fiends right here and now.
Burning down a temple is going too far.
Aw, come on, Waka. You're thinking about this whole burning the temple down thing the wrong way. Just think of it like, happy festival fireworks. You fucking dolt. And that raises an interesting thought. Why are people so attached to these fucking buildings? They were built to honor a false god responsible for the deaths of billions. It'd be like having a Hitler building in your hometown.
Praying to them never did anyone any good.
So for a long stretch of this game, you just go from town to town clearing temples, and at the bottom of each temple is a Dark Aeon you have to kill off. What I find really funny about this is that our brave heroes, who defeated sin against suicidal odds, are now extorting money out of people before they'll even attempt to save them from monsters. Oh, wait a second. Hey, Bartello, how many syllables does the name Donna have?
Donna!
Huh, so about 6 then. Yeah, interesting. And his blank zombie-like expression completely matches the urgent tone of his voice.
Donna!
Anyway, at the bottom of one of the temples, you fight another Aeon, and during the battle, Yuna's knocked into one of the infinite holes.
Ah, you can hear me.
This is the construct. It's our loading program.
After falling forever, it seems, she awakens in a green field, surrounded by flowers, with the sun on her face.
Do not be troubled, for you are in Elysium, and you're already dead!
And she meets a guy she saw in the sphere who looks exactly like Titus.
I looked for you for so long. While I wandered, I realized something. Spira hasn't really changed at all. Everyone's still fighting over nothing, still dying like they used to. Vegnagun will make that all go away.
You know, is it just me, or do none of the villains' plans in any of the Final Fantasy games make any fucking sense? And they all basically boil down to the same fundamental concept, that the world is full of pain and suffering and disappointment, and the only way to stop people from suffering is to kill them. Guys like Kefka were just gibbering insane, at least, who just wanted to watch the world burn, and I guess Sephiroth kinda had more of a plan in that he wanted to become a god or see his alien mom or something, but Jeez, Shuyin comes off like a complete crybaby. I'm sick of all the violence and hate in the world, so I'm gonna violently hate-fuck the world in half with my Doomsday Weapon's mile-long cock gun. Yuna talks to Shuyin for a while, and instead of making plans for coffee or a movie later, he tells her he's so happy to see her again, he's gonna blow her up along with the rest of the world with Vecna Gun. I mean, dude, seriously, you really don't have that much of a reason to be upset anymore, because your dead girlfriend that you were so sad about, she's right there. So, you lack what we call motivation. Your priority's a little out of whack. So Shuyin bugs off, and Yuna stays in this weird dimension until she's just sort of not anymore, and she gets out to explain her story to the other ladies.
Then, huh?
Yeah, the girl from the Songstress Stressphere.
Okay, so when Shuyin dies, his emo-ness rises from the grave to gain enough power to threaten the entire world, and when Len, a summoner, dies, she goes on to haunt a dress sphere? How is that fair? And if Len wore Yuna's dress, who wore Riku's songstress dress, or Payne's female Elvis jumpsuit, or was Len just freaky like that?
I hate to interrupt, but Spear's falling apart with its leaders missing. Check the comm spheres and see.
Oh yeah, things look absolutely batshit right now. Oh god, look at the carnage. Oh, the humanity.
Yuna gets on the radio to get updates from around the world, from Waka, Donna, the Youth League, etc. It seems the leaders of both the major political factions of Spira, the Youth League and New Yevon, have gone missing. They're both planning sneak attacks on each other since their leadership structures are destabilized, and they both see an opportunity for victory.
Looks like Nuge and Barrelai still haven't come back. And now Gipple's vanished too.
And Vegnagun's on the loose. You can bet Shuyin's controlling that thing.
I changed my mind. I want to do something. Nuge asked me to help, and that's what I'll do.
So, with the world poised on the brink of war, and Shuyin preparing to rain global thermonuclear fire on Spira, the ladies put their heads together and decide to come up with a plan. And they decide the best course of action is...
Sing campfire songs?
Oh!
To hold a concert!
All of Spira will be the captive of Yuna singing and dancing!
A concert! A concert! You know, one would think after the discussion we just had, specifically addressing the causes of the coming war, they might decide to do something a little more proactive, like, I don't know, finding and rescuing the missing faction leaders, maybe that might have more of a lasting impact on people than Yuna's shitty J-pop, but regardless of whether or not you really believe a concert is going to diffuse all of these intricate socio-political tensions, isn't all this speculation rather pointless in the face of the looming apocalypse brought on by fucking Vegnacock? No, I'm being serious here. Shuyin fucking hijacked a doomsday machine, and Yuna's plan is to hold a concert. How is it fucking possible that this fucking guy, is the sensible one and brings up the only viable plan of destroying Vegnagun, which you'd think would be priority number one with a fucking bullet, and that plan is shot down to hold a fucking concert? This isn't a Final Fantasy game. It's the ending to Empire Records. This concert bullshit might have saved Arnold in an episode of fucking Happy Days, but somehow, I kinda doubt that it's gonna solve the geopolitical issues of an entire fucking planet. If I wanna use music to unite the world in peace and harmony, I'll stick with the Wild Stallions. So to hold the concert, you have to go find those fucking freak show musicians all over again, and please, God, don't make me push them into a fucking elevator again.
Spectacularly spectacular! 'Twill be a yummy Unipalooza indeed! 'Twill go down in history!
Oh, I hope they really do call it Unipalooza.
A minor detail, where or where should it be?
Well, the more people we can gather together, the better.
Aha! Then how about the Thunder Plains? Yes! You could practically pack a plethora of people in that place.
What, you mean that place you literally can't go three steps without getting fatally struck by lightning? Oh yeah, yeah, I like that. Let's fill that with thousands of people in a tightly packed mob, and then put Yuna on an enormous steel stage surrounded by electronic equipment. What the fuck is wrong with you? I'm just saying, this is what happens when these people book your concert.
Advertising is our specialty.
Okay, I know, I don't mean to harp on this because really the point is basically meaningless, but if you just stop and think for a second,
None of this makes any sense. Yeah, let's hold a concert on the fucking Thunder Plains, one of the most fundamentally dangerous environments on all of Spira, because God knows there's not a single wide-open stretch of land anywhere on Spira where we can hold a concert. Oh, right, yeah. That huge, wide-open, completely safe field. Whoops. Oh, and guess what? That area has concession vendors already established. Or what about the wide-open Blitzball Amphitheater? Or here's a thought. How about the concert hall you just showed us having a concert in at the beginning of the fucking game?
But what are you gonna sing? Wow, did you write that?
Because it really sucks ass.
It's more like I felt it. I can hear it echoing inside me.
You mean to tell me that she's about to give a concert in front of the entire world's population? And she doesn't have any songs prepared? Oh, geez. This concert is going to eat. Strap in, folks. Prepare yourselves for some more bubbly, meaningless J-pop.
I know that you're hiding things, using gentle words to shelter me.
Was actually really good.
No, really, I'm not kidding. When I played this game the first time, I was legitimately dreading this scene, especially after the god-awful Real Emotion opening. But this scene is honestly pretty damn brilliant. I guess I'll start with the song itself, which I find to be a very inspiring and heartfelt love song, and it perfectly matches Yuna's emotions and memories of her short-lived romance that ended in tragedy. The lyrics are, you know, translated, kind of blunt force trauma, but the vocal performances I thought really nailed the emotion of the song. This scene is also stunningly well directed. It manages to tell the entire tragic romance between Shuyin and Len and their connection to Yuna's own story without actually saying a single word of exposition. In 3 minutes, I had more emotional investment in Len's tragic death and Shuyin's mournful existence without her than I did mucking through 40 hours of Titus and Yuna's bumbling, uncomfortable affair in Final Fantasy X. So I don't want to hear ever again that I can't say anything nice about Final Fantasy, okay? I'm fucking pissed I can't be fucking pissed at this scene. That's how good it is. Jesus, sucks. I need to nitpick something. Let me watch this again.
Rehearsal starting!
Okay, I got one.
Before the concert, there's some kind of stupid rhythm dancing minigame you gotta do with Riku, but why do you have to do this when this choreographed dance number you do never actually happens on stage? It's entirely pointless. And what kind of lame-ass concert only features one single song? Okay, there. Now I feel better.
The lovers met a truly tragic end. Those images we all witnessed are most certainly a record of their last moments.
Wait, so everyone saw that flashback? Okay, how? I mean, did Len's spirit project it on the concert Jumbotron?
Everything is all wrong.
Alright, moving on. So Shinra gets a signal from a probe droid they dropped into one of the Vegna holes, and they discover the guys they're looking for already down there, working together to stop Vegnacock. Never knew these guys were that badass, but now that Yuna's once again united the world in song, that means the rescue mission can finally start.
Inconceivable!
You keep using the word. I don't think it means what you think it means.
We know Vegna Gun is in the deepest reaches of the far plane. The only way in is to jump into one of those holes.
Yeah, but which one?
Who cares? We just pick a hole and dive!
Now, you can jump in the hole, or you can take this opportunity to do a few thousand hours of side quests. Probably the best one to do is to help this guy Clasco start a chocobo farm, because the payoff is he gives you the Alchemist Dress Sphere. And as soon as you can go Alchemist, the game is basically over, because that class allows you to pull an infinite number of Mega Potions straight out of your ass to heal 2,000 hit points for free whenever you want. You're basically immortal once that happens, and combined with the Samurai class, which allows instant KOs of every standard enemy, leveling up barely requires looking at the screen. And you'll notice that most of the advanced dress spheres can be pretty easily manipulated to completely destroy the main storyline quest. I also took this time and went back to Besaid because I made enough money to finally buy that incredibly expensive item from the beginning of the game, but guess what? When you get there, someone's already bought it! And this lady's still working here? Shit! I think I'd close shop early and retire. Oh, and Lulu dresses her baby like a Moogle. Yeah, motherhood pretty much destroyed Lulu's gothic sexy look. Okay, back to the story. You jump down a hole and for some reason don't die. You find yourself on the Zen level from Half-Life, where you fight a bunch more Aeons, including Shiva.
You betrayed Shiva! God thank you, betrayed Shiva!
Alright, so this part gets pretty stupid, and there's basically no good explanation for it, so you kinda gotta bear with me here. You find Nuge, yeah, I still can't believe that's really his name, and Nuge tells you that Shuyin has possessed the other guy named Barilai and used his body to steal Vegna Gun. Because apparently, unsent can do that when they're pissed off enough. I guess it's kinda like that guy in the movie Fallen, where he can possess people and make them do evil things. But that movie was awesome, and this game doesn't really do anything with it. I don't even know why he bothers, considering Shuyin can do things just fine on his own. Dude doesn't seem to have a problem holding a sword and kicking vast amounts of ass in his spirit form, know what I'm saying? But hey, right now we're rolling with the possession thing. Nuge decides the only way to stop Shuyin is to cripple the body he possesses by shooting Barilai a lot. Then Shuyin will need to look for a new body to inhabit, then possess Nuge, and Nuge will blow himself up with a suicide bomb.
My body has already been rigged. I'm taking Shuyin with me.
I don't like your plan. It sucks.
Why? It kinda sounds like he put a fair amount of thought into this plan, and hey Yuna, what were you doing when Nuge was heroically preparing to sacrifice himself to save the lives of billions? Uh-huh, so, you can just shut the fuck up.
Your plan is awful. Think about it. It's no different than what we did 2 years ago. We destroyed our own allies. We destroyed the Aeons who had fought together with us at our side.
Yeah, and guess what? It worked! So, not seeing the problem here, and I'm not even hearing a plan B from this side, so come on, Yuna. Come on, genius. If there's a plan B, we would all love to hear it.
Plan B!
Oh.
Love.
Oh.
The power of love conquers all. So romantic. Count me in.
This is the girliest plan ever. And before they can, love Shuyin, they still have to somehow destroy Vegna Gun to get to him. Alright, I have already lost the plot completely. Wasn't that what we were just talking about, was how to stop Vegna Gun? And so they settled on appealing to Shuyin with the power of love, but to do that they have to stop Vegna Gun, so the plan is they have no plan.
If we all attack at once, we can do this! We need to split up!
Oh, okay, I see now. The plan here, this is Rich, the plan is to attack fucking Vegna Gun head on. Three chicks with swords against a mech the size of a fucking building whose sole function is to eradicate all life on the planet. No, this plan sucks. I know it's in the spirit of a Final Fantasy game to have a climactic showdown with a boss that threatens all life on the planet, but, you know, it sort of undermines the menace of your Doomsday Mega Weapon if three people don't even bat an eye at the thought of taking it on in a straight-up fight. I mean, let's be real here. Just yesterday, they were having trouble taking these guys on, and now they want to do a full frontal assault on something that was designed to annihilate armies! It's not strictly head-on, though. They split up into three teams. The girls attack the tail, while the others occupy other parts of Vegna Gun. But, of course, the other team sucks, so you end up having to fight every part of Vegna Gun anyway. Gotta do everything around here, don't I?
All of Spira is finished.
He's got a plan B, too!
Oh, yeah. And that plan B? Deploy the Vegna Cock!
Come. Vegnagun, let us purge this repulsive world!
If you take too long in this fight, the Vegnacock blows its load and pretty much destroys the entire world and you get the bad ending. But it sucks, so who cares anyway. It turns out that Vegnagun is controlled by an impressive array of piano-style keyboards, which to me seems awfully, terribly, you know, horrendously inconvenient for a weapons delivery system. It's like Vegnagun was designed by the band Yes.
Dude, play Van Halen's Jump!
There's something I must tell you. Words left unspoken for 1,000 years. I love you.
We can finally fade. Together. No.
You are not Len!
Oh, well, there you have it. So much for that love plan, huh? Good one, Yuna. Now you see, the power of emo beats love every time, baby! Every time! Well, it's the final boss battle, and to this game's credit, at least Shuyin puts up a fight, unlike fucking Yu Yevon. Dude fights exactly like Titus, too, right down to his ultimate finishing move where he wrecks your shit with a blitz ball. Yeah, he's got a blitz ball, too. This guy's gonna conquer the world, and he carries a blitz ball. We're actually meant to take this seriously.
Put that crybaby to sleep!
Alright, time out! No, time out, hang on. Did you guys just hear that?
Not much longer now!
Yes, that voice that keeps giving you advice during the last boss fight, it took me for fucking ever to figure out where I'd heard that before.
Don't let up! Keep fighting!
Right, and you know who that is? That's Jekt, Titus's dad, and to this I just... What in the hell is Jekt doing here? And this ties right into an issue I've been thinking about for years when it comes to this game, and I've never been able to find a satisfactory answer to it. It's very simple. What in the hell is the deal with Shuyin? The game makes it clear from the beginning that Titus and Shuyin are not supposed to be the same person, but they are, kind of. They are, but they're not. Shuyin was a real blitzball player in The Real Xanarkand. Okay, fine, I get that part. And apparently Titus is some kind of recreation of Shuyin, a dream constructed by the Faith in Dream Xanarkand, and the Faith are like the souls of the dead or something. And the reason Titus is different is because the Faith have an imperfect memory of Shuyin, so he's close, but not quite the same. You follow me so far? That's okay. I don't think I follow me either. I mean, the way I've explained it, it kind of makes sense, but as soon as you start asking any kind of questions about this, the whole thing just falls apart. Like, how could they have such an imperfect memory of a major Xanarkand celebrity? I mean, dude played blitzball. They got his face and body exactly right, but not his name? What the hell? Not to mention, the guy almost enacted genocide with a doomsday weapon. You'd think he'd be pretty well remembered in the news. Plus, the guy was dating Len, one of the most famous summoners and pop singers in Xanarkand. And not only is Len nowhere to be seen in Dream Xanarkand, Titus never mentions having a smoking hot girlfriend back in Xanarkand to anybody. And trust me, Titus is exactly the kind of douchebag who would never shut the fuck up about this kind of thing to anybody. Hey, I'm dating this super hot singer, you know. Her name's Len. I even touched her boob one time. I'm the star player of the Xanarkand Aves. Because is it like in Final Fantasy X, when the Faith make Dream Xanarkand, is Sin supposed to destroy Dream Xanarkand before Titus meets Len? Well, why would that happen and not the war with Bevel? And what about Orin? Doesn't he notice anything unusual about any of this? Because he actually is from the real Xanarkand. He actually is an unsensed spirit. He doesn't notice the completely different personality or the different name, or his stunning similarity to a famous blitzball player named Shuyun. And then I realized, you know, they never actually say his name in Final Fantasy X, at least not in a voiced video clip. So, is it possible that the fact that nobody refers to Titus by name a plot point? Like, if Titus had ever introduced himself or anyone had bothered to ask his name, would Orin have, like, looked confused and been all, "Titus? Wait a minute, your name's Shuyun, isn't it? What the fuck is the matter with you?" Well, apparently nobody bothered because nobody refers to Titus by name in 10-2 either, meaning Yuna fucked a guy whose name she didn't know. Oh my god, I'm rambling. I gotta pull. Okay, here's my point. My point is, if Shuyun and Titus are two different entities, wouldn't Jekt know about this? Because I thought the whole point of Final Fantasy X was that Jekt raised Titus to hate him so he'd be willing to kill his own father when Jekt became Sin, because that's why Titus has all his daddy issues, right? So if Jekt is Titus's father and Titus isn't real, okay, that doesn't make sense. Because if he's not real, how does he have a... if he is, why is he here calling Shuyun a crybaby? Because, okay, I thought they were different people, or did Jekt raise the real Shuyun and the Dream Titus as children in Dream Xanarkand? Because that doesn't make sense, and that's fucking weird. Okay, I mean, I guess because they both have the same moves, And then there's the thing where you can unlock the Xanarkand Abes in the Blitzball minigame, and the thing is, Titus is there, but instead of being called Titus, he's called Star Player, and why wouldn't they call... I almost talked through the ending. What happens? Len and Shuyun fuck off, and the Youth League and New Yevon guys are friends now, even though they shouldn't, because they've, like, killed thousands of people, and Yuna's become strong and independent and crap, and she fucks off, and, that's kind of it. Unless you played the game for months and got 100% completion, in which case you get this. And Titus comes back, and, there he is. He's sure there. Yeah, all that time and effort, that was totally worth it to see this guy again. Hooray.
I got a theory. I think the Faith gathered up my thoughts and put them together to bring me back. Or maybe I'm still a dream.
Dude, I don't think even the Faith really know. And if you don't know, what the fuck chance do I have? You bitch! Did she just try to kill him? Because if he is real, she just pushed him off a cliff to die pulverized against jagged fucking rocks.
That's not cherishing.
Oh my god. Guys, I just had a terrible thought. Now that I'm done with the game, that means I have to fight a character from the game. And that means... Oh my god. You are the sexiest woman I've ever seen in my life. Well, that's just great. There goes Plan A. Oreo? Puppy! Go get help! Oreo!
go get the guns in my closet. The guns! You can do it! Go! I really don't know what you're so mad about. I was pretty complimentary to your game, all things considered. It's just a game, lady. Really don't see what you're so upset. Oh, right. I violently murdered your boyfriend with a gunblade. Shit. Oreo! Bring the guns!
Cool. Guns! Lots of guns!
Whoa.
Gonna do? Sing me to death with that? I'm blind!
Whatever.